because they have some strange religious belief. Dr. Rakib Ehsan, I probably got your name wrong. I apologize profusely. Research fellow from the Center for Radicalization and Terrorism at the Henry Jackson Society. Is that right?
That's right, James.
Okay, matey, listen. What are your thoughts on this? How do we stop it? What do we do?
Well, I think that there's a recent announcement by the Justice Secretary, Robert Buckland, and it seems like the government's going to introduce an emergency law to end early prisoner release. I think after what happened with the London Bridge terrorist attack and the more recent Islamist terrorist attack in Streatham, I do think that's a step in the right direction.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, but why has it taken this long to do?
If I'm being honest, James, I think that we've had a political elite and also a judicial elite who instinctively, when making decisions, when looking to pass counter-extremism legislation, they haven't prioritised the interests of the broader public safety the way they should. I think all too often there's been an emphasis on the individual rights of convicted terrorists, when in reality we should be focusing on ensuring the safety and stability of our local communities.
Yeah, because after the London Bridge attack, that's when all the discussion came that we've got to change the legislation, but it hasn't happened. It should have been like emergency pushed through, but I think because of the Brexit thing going on in the background, it was sort of put on the back burner a bit.
I think that's a possibility, and I think all too often we've placed too much faith in these rehabilitation courses run by the Home Office looking to de-radicalise convicted terrorists. But all too often it's been a case of misplaced idealism. We haven't been hard-headed enough and realistic when examining prospects for rehabilitation of people. Some of them have been, you know, been found guilty of multiple terrorism-related offences, such as the terrorist behind the recent Streatham terrorist attack.
I mean, have we actually any proof that we can de-radicalise some of these people or not?
Well, I think the issue there is we're dealing with individuals who are quite cunning, some of them remarkably intelligent.
Yeah.
That's the truth. So there is the risk that they could dupe or trick counsellors who are working on those de-radicalisation rehabilitative schemes, essentially giving them the impression that they have been successfully de-radicalised. They do reject these fundamentalist, violent ideologies. But in reality, that they're still firmly wedded to these ideologies. And then once they are released back into the wider public, they still have intentions to carry out violent acts of terrorism.
Well, that's what happened on London Bridge, and it also gave them access to coming into central London.
Well, it's
quite
remarkable that Usman Khan, who's behind the London Bridge terrorist attack, he actually conducted his deadly acts of terror at a prisoner rehabilitation conference.
And killed two people that were involved in rehabilitating him.
Absolutely.
I mean, there's a story in the Sun today, Jihadists on the Loose, and I think you probably know about this because I think it came from your society. At least 20 are back in London where they committed the terror offences that put them in jail. According to a Sun investigation last night, the Henry Jackson Society think tank said that your probe's findings were deeply disturbing.
Well, I'd make the point that if you're looking at the London Bridge and Streatham Islamist terrorist attacks, I have to say, I think public confidence in both the judicial system and the effectiveness of counter-extremism agencies, it'll be significantly damaged following these acts of terrorism. And I'd have to say that early release individuals who have been convicted of a spate of terrorism-related offences, such as Sudesh Aman, who is behind the Streatham terrorist attack, and Usman Khan, who's behind the London Bridge terrorist attack, these people, they represent a very serious risk pool within British society, and collectively they pose a fundamental threat to the safety and stability of our local communities. So I think that public authorities all too often they have failed to prioritise our national security and broader public safety.
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree. But what is going to be done? We can't just continue these arguments between people who think that they know better.
Well, I think I'll make the point that so the Justice Secretary, Robert Buckland, he says that now, whether it's current or future offenders, people convicted of terrorism-related offences, they'll only be released until they've served at least two-thirds of their sentence and that their release is approved by the parole board. Because quite often people have been released automatically without any involvement or any assessment from the parole board. So I do think it's a step in the right direction. But if you're talking about, you know, how realistic should we be when it comes to examining the prospects of people being successfully rehabilitated, I do think we need to be more hard-headed and we need to be more rational when we're making those decisions.
It seems to be that when they get older, they get de-radicalised. When they get late 30s, early 40s, so maybe just keep them in long enough.
Well, no, you said... Go on, sorry.
Sorry, but I'd also make the point that we have to see... that there's different shades of extremism. But the reality of the matter is we had a gentleman... well, I call him gentleman. That's me being exceptionally polite. We have a convicted terrorist here in Sudesh Oman. He actually instructed one of his romantic partners to decapitate her parents because he believed they were kuffar, that they were disbelievers. So we're dealing with someone who was very supportive of violent extremism. So the idea that this person was released halfway through what I would consider to be a lenient prison sentence of 3 years and 4 months, I think much of the British public will find that absolutely mind-boggling. So if you are looking to rehabilitate individuals, you have to make sure that they're given lengthy enough prison sentences in order for rehabilitation to even be a realistic prospect, because that takes a hell of a lot of time.
So how long would someone like that have got?
It differs from individual to individual, but I think in this case, we're talking about someone who was already given an initial prison sentence of 3 years and 4 months, and then he was auto-released after serving only half of that sentence. I can tell you now, even with favourable conditions, that is not long enough.
No.
That is simply not long enough at all. And we have to examine what we're working to begin with. You know, what stage of radicalisation is that specific individual at? We need to be more rational and we need to examine this with a more hard-headed mindset.
But they get radicalised in prison, don't they, as well?
Well, I think that's another issue. So a lot of people talk about, it's going against their human rights if they're placed in solitary confinement. But the reality of the matter is, if there is a risk of perhaps an individual radicalising other prisoners, that person should be isolated.
Yeah.
Because they are a serious threat in terms of potentially radicalising fellow inmates. That needs to be part of the discussion. I think all too often we've been talking about human rights for people who have clearly broken the law and they've intended to carry out acts of terrorism. But it's time to be more hard-headed and prioritise the broader public interest.
Why do you think the last two of these people, London Bridge and this one, have had these fake suicide vests on? What was the point of that?
I think that it's a strategy. It's a tactic that is increasingly being seen with these attacks. I think what's also interesting, though, if I could add, is the fact that Sudesh Oman, who's behind the Streatham terrorist attack, he used a knife. Now, interestingly, when he was initially in prison, one of the terrorist materials that was found in his possession was a manual instructing how to use a knife in an effective manner.
Yeah.
People will find this absolutely bonkers. They will, that this person... And it's very similar with Usman Khan, who was initially in prison for being part of a terror plot on the London Stock Exchange. He's then released, he's then placed on rehabilitation courses. What does he go on to do? Conduct a terrorist attack in London.
Yeah.
And this is unacceptable. The British public, they will not stand for it much further. So I do think that the Justice Secretary's announcement, it's a welcome one.
I do. I think that Boris will do everything he can. I think he'll get a lot of things thrown in his way, unfortunately. But, you know, we spend money on all sorts of strange things. We should be spending a little bit more money on this and sorting it out. We lock up people who don't need to be there. We could deal with them in some other way. And then say, we haven't got enough prison spaces or we don't know. This guy who just came out obviously had around about 30 police officers keeping tabs on him.
Well, that's costly in itself.
Yeah,
I'll
say.
Listen, I think that we hear a lot about costs, but ultimately... You know, we've seen the London Bridge terrorist attack cost the lives of two young people. Fortunately, On this occasion, no one has been killed, but multiple people were stabbed.
Mm. And one guy does have very serious injuries.
Mm. Mm. So I think in reality, we could talk about costs, but we talk about the cost of, keeping people in prison, but the potential human cost of releasing people who remain deeply dangerous individuals into our local communities, you can't place a price on that. You really can't. When you're talking about financial costs. So as I said, the public authorities, they need to better prioritise the public safety and national security. That needs to be their focus. Because I think all too often, if I'm being perfectly honest, I think there's been a bit too much virtue signalling when it comes to counter-extremism.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Would it do any good bringing back capital punishment, even if it is just a lethal injection?
Well, James, I think I remember when you had me on your show last year, I did express my support for that in certain cases. And I think that, interestingly, I would say this. If people don't have confidence in the judicial system and the sentencing regime that is in place for convicted terrorists who want to do fundamental harm to ordinary members of the public, you will see a backlash and you will see an increase in support for certain crimes. You will see support for capital punishment.
But they don't care about dying. They all have died anyway. Well, they all know they're going to die.
That's the issue. And I think that's a very important point that you raise. Because in this sense, if you were to introduce capital punishment and apply the death sentence, many of these Islamist terrorists, they crave martyrdom. They want to be seen as martyrs. And I think in that sense, you don't want to provide that narrative of the state taking someone's life and then making them a martyr. Because in a sense, that could actually backfire when you're looking to deal with the scourge of Islamist extremism. So it's a complicated issue. It's difficult.
Rakib, thank you for your time.